Next thing I want to announce is Zen Server is now available on Amazon EC2 on a pay-as-you-go basis. So you can, if you're an Amazon user, you have a limited amount of servers. If you have a huge amount of servers, you probably want to get an unlimited subscription that we have. But if you have a limited amount of servers and you want to buy Zen Server on a pay-as-you-go basis, you can do that already today. It's been in beta for probably about 2 to 3 months, and we've already had quite a few people who signed up for it. So go ahead and give it a try. Last thing I wanted to talk about is performance and work that we've actually done in the past year around performance of PHP. We've spent a lot of time actually working on the Zend engine, which is the kernel of PHP. It's the virtual machine within PHP. We did a lot of work in improving the performance. We also worked very closely with Intel to both profile it, make it run better, faster on x86 chips, and work with the Intel compilers that are actually giving much better performance right now than what we see with GCC. And we've managed to push the envelope on PHP. When we tested in real-world applications that are just accessing database in a very simple way, such as whether it's a Drupal or Magento, the performance enhancements we see are probably between 10 and 20%. But when you actually look at the raw runtime, we get up to 250% performance improvement of the language itself. Probably most important is we've managed to lower the memory footprint of PHP. So we've actually managed to lower the footprint by up to 35%, which what that means is you can run between up to 35% more PHP processes on a given server. So there are a lot more requests per second that you're going to be able to serve. All these patches have been contributed to PHP. So they're already an open source. They're part of a future version of PHP, so they're not out yet. But I did want to mention it because there's still a lot of innovation that we're doing on actually just pushing the runtime itself. So before we talk about the future, I promised a little preview of a movie. And this is actually a clip that I found on YouTube. And I'm just going to play the first part of the clip. I thought it was a really cool clip. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. You can see the full clip on YouTube. I hope you liked it as much as I did. When I started watching it in my living room, my kids, who are big Star Wars fans, came and wanted me to replay it endless times. But I think it, what it reflects for me is really a lot of the, interest, around cloud. And that's actually what I want to talk about. Where we're going with cloud and where Zend believes the value in cloud is. So talking about a cloud, we've been probably talking about it for about 2 years. And the big question here is, how game-changing is it really? Is it just hype? What do you guys think? Is it game-changing? Raise your hands. Who thinks it's just hype? Okay, so we're probably 50-50. I think there's another third that I'm not sure what they voted. I think from my point of view, I'm pragmatic about it. I think there are there's obviously some hype around cloud. I think there's different people interpret cloud in a different way. From our point of view, though, there are elements of cloud that are going to be game-changing, in our opinion, for our customers, and are going to be very, very valuable to you. And let me talk about areas where I think you can get real benefits out of the cloud. The first one is cost benefits. So if you think of public cloud, the economies of scale that are giving you a well-priced, pay-as-you-go model, and those dollars are also going to go down over time. I think in the public cloud, there are going to be a lot of opportunities to get real cost benefits when you're driving workloads. I think when you think of private cloud, being able to use your resources more effectively, being able to spin up servers for developers without waiting 2 to 3 weeks for IT to actually do it, all those benefits are going to translate into real dollars that you're going to save. The second point, which for me is really, I would say, the most important one, is what I call do it right for the masses. My experience is that there are really very few companies who are successful in building truly scalable, truly manageable, and highly available system architectures for web applications. Everyone tries, but it really requires a huge amount of skill and a huge amount of investment to make that happen. We've, of course, worked with many customers to make that happen. But what we see cloud as an opportunity to really do it for the masses, bring those best practices, bring system architectures that just work that way out of the box, and enable everyone to use that without having to build it. The third one is much, much better lifecycle support. So the industry has really worked on application lifecycle probably for the past 20 years. A lot of problems have been solved, but it is still very, very hard for companies to build very good lifecycle support into their development process. Going from development to QA to testing, staging, and production, you still have multiple breakdowns. And so when I mentioned the VMware workstation integration, that solves kind of a first piece of the breakdown, which is developers developing to systems that are different than what the production systems look like. We think that with cloud, we're actually going to be able to deliver a much more streamlined process, make it much easier for developers to build to a common platform that is consistent, and that's the thing we're going to focus on. And then fourth is freedom, is really giving you choice of where, when, and how you want to deploy your applications. You're going to have much more choice if it's your private cloud, public cloud, numerous public cloud vendors. And we think that freedom is ultimately going to help you be more agile, get projects launched faster, and also eliminate vendor lock-in for a lot of you. So really, a few things we're going to focus on. The first one is building that system architecture and making it work out of the box. So making it scalable, making it reliable, and making it highly available. We're going to continue to push the application lifecycle from studio into desktop virtualization, into server virtualization, and ultimately into the cloud. And then I would say the last tenet is really for us to give you choice. So our goal is not to become a cloud infrastructure provider or to do cloud management for you. Our goal is to be a technology enabler for a variety of clouds and make sure that whatever cloud you choose, you have this robust PHP cloud platform. And so when we think about the Zen PHP cloud platform, it really deals with a variety of issues, and we're going to integrate that into cloud management, into cloud infrastructures, and into various cloud services. And we're actually going to do a demo for you in a few minutes, so you actually get a real good sense of what we're talking about. So we're going to deal with things like portability. Simple cloud is part of that, and we've talked about it before. We're going to give you high availability. We're going to help integrate the full application lifecycle as part of that. application and service level monitoring. So we already do PHP monitoring today. We do code tracing today. But really, we believe we can give you a full application level view and a service level view. So if you're leveraging services from your cloud provider, we're going to integrate the monitoring of those services into our product line. And then probably most important is elasticity. We're going to support elasticity. We're going to support auto-deployment of your applications as your server, as the number of servers in your application changes. And again, as I said before, you're actually going to see a demo, so you're going to get some feeling for what that looks like. If we go one level deeper, you'll see we've actually made a lot of progress already in this direction. So we've added native cloud application services support in Xen Framework. We've done Simple Cloud. We've started integrating Xen Studio with VMware Workstation. We're looking at integrating it into other cloud vendors. We started integrating with a cloud management partner of ours, which you're going to see. And so ultimately, what you're going to get is a Xen PHP cloud platform from Xen that gives you the runtime service layer, the management, the framework, and of course, accessibility to all the different cloud services. Because ultimately, if you want to build a truly scalable PHP application, it's not going to be enough for you. It's not going to be enough if we make just PHP scale. Your data sources have to scale. Your storage has to scale. And so giving you the tie-ins into whether it's Amazon S3 or Amazon SimpleDB or other services that cloud providers are going to deliver, that's going to ultimately help you build truly scalable applications that can scale out as much as you want. And rest assured, pretty much every cloud infrastructure provider today is working on delivering cloud services. And they're working on delivering scalable cloud services, whether it's Amazon, Windows Azure, or a lot of other cloud vendors that are working on this. I talked about lifecycle, so I won't go into too much detail anymore. But as I said, the Xen Studio integration with VMware Workstation is really the first step. It gives you that initial consistency. But ultimately, our goal is to go deeper, go into the full data center virtualized environment, and then go into the public cloud. And as you're leveraging Xen Framework's cloud service connections in your applications, as you port those over into whatever cloud provider you want, those are going to work through Simple Cloud, and they're going to scale through the products that we're going to deliver. About a month ago, we announced a partnership with RightScale. RightScale is one of the leading cloud management providers for Amazon. And we basically announced the first part of the strategy, which is a dev and test pack. So you can go today already to RightScale, buy a dev and test pack that has Xen Server within it. But ultimately, the goal is to deliver the Xen PHP cloud platform with RightScale in production. And that's actually what we're going to demo. We're going to demo what that's going to look like, an initial version of that, and you can see already a lot of it works and a lot of the scalability aspects we're already getting today. There's one major feature that we're missing in Xen Server, which we believe is critical to enabling these cloud deployments, and that's application deployment. And so what you're going to see today is a preview version of application deployment that we're adding to Xen Server. What we're going to enable is, again, the full workflow. We're going to enable you to take your project in Xen Studio, export it as a package, and then deploy it onto a cluster through a very high-performance deployment engine within Xen Server. That deployment engine is going to support things like versioning, like rollback. So it's really going to enable you to use it as a very professional way to deploy your applications. It's going to work in the cloud and also on premise. So if you're running on bare metal and so on, we're still going to support that paradigm. But the most important piece here is that it's going to have an auto deploy feature. So as we scale up, if your application load goes up and we launch more servers to deal with that load, those servers are going to know to connect to our cluster manager, and they're going to ask the cluster manager for its configuration. They're going to get all the applications deployed to it, and then they're going to join the cluster. And of course, ultimately, they're also going to register themselves with the load balancer. So all the deployment, all the scale up and the elasticity is going to work automatically with Zen Server and through the platform that we're building. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Kent Mitchell, our Director of Product Management, onto stage. And Kent's going to show you a demo of what we're building. And I was really excited when I saw it, even though I knew what we were building. I think the way it actually turned out was even better than what I had anticipated. Thank you.
So now that Andy's built that all up tremendously, I'll try not to fail desperately. All of you have probably at some point in your life demoed software that wasn't quite ready to be released yet, and this is probably not going to be released for several months. So bear with me. If anything unusual happens, we'll try to explain our way out of it. How many people in here have actually seen Zen Server before and used it? Okay, good number of people. That's great. Love to see that. So this is Zen Server Cluster Manager. This is the clustered version that Andy was talking about, and what you can see here is the same kinds of things you would see from Zen Server. So you can see recent events that have happened. So these are things that have gone on in the system, like slow requests, bad PHP function calls, various other things in the system. And down below here, you can see that we have actually a collection of servers. Now I'm going to do a couple things during this demo. Sometimes I'm going to have very large views up so you can sort of see the whole thing. And then at various points, I'm going to try to zoom in like this so you can actually see what's on the screen, because I know from the back it wasn't very visible. But I think when we zoom in like that, it looks a little better. Does that seem pretty good to people? Get them getting the thumbs up from the back. OK, so what we've got here is we've got Zen Server, as I said. And we've got various information in here in this dashboard. We can look at the events that are out there, and we can see what kinds of events we have. So we have slow request execution. We've got a few other things. If I sort by the count of the events, I'll see the things that are happening most often. So I'm getting a lot of curl exec function errors. I'm getting a lot of slow queries. And there's various other things in here that you can see. So you can go in to set up the cluster, and you can see all of the servers that are running in the cluster. So here you can see that we have 15 servers running in this cluster right now. And you can do things like centrally manage the configuration. So I can see what components are in the system, like this. And if I wanted to turn on a particular component, a particular Zen component, I do it here. And it's going to push that change automatically to the cluster. If I need to turn on or off a particular extension, same thing. I can do it one place here on Zen Server Cluster Manager, and it'll automatically push that and update the entire cluster consistently. You've got extensions. You've got the ability to change various directives for PHP, for example, such as file upload size and other things. And again, centralizing the management of that. So we've got centralized configuration, centralized management. And we've now got the ability to see the status of the servers and start to deploy applications. So here's, as I said, an application deployment. This is a very early prototype. We've got one application already deployed into our cluster. That's the WordPress application. So I'm going to click on that. You can see that WordPress is running. And I'm going to actually bring up the Drupal app, which is not running. So you can see that's 404. And go to Zen Server Cluster Manager. And what I want to do is tell it to add an application, which is this button over here. So now I'll zoom in a little bit so we can actually see what's going on. So in order to add an application, I have to upload a package. And Andy talked about how do you create a package. So let's go over to Zen Studio for a second. And first thing I want to do is look at this project that I have here. So it's a Drupal project. It's got a directory in it called data, which actually has my application in it. It's got another directory in it called scripts. Scripts are various sets of hooks that you'll be able to do during deployment to automate certain aspects. So you can do in these scripts things that set up the database. You can do things that do pre-deployment operations, various other things. Then there's an XML file that sort of describes the package. And the format of this package that we're going to build is, in fact, just a simple zip file. So you can use this particular technology. It's based loosely on the PECL package format, so it should be something that people are fairly familiar with. And any kind of automated tool that's out there doing automated builds or automated testing can automate the construction of this package and put it out there. And so what you see here in this XML file is some of the information that you can specify. Like you can specify the minimum PHP version this package needs. You can specify which extensions need to be enabled. So if the Zen server is is uploading this package and it sees that an extension needs to be turned on for this package to run, it'll automatically make that configuration change. You can see things like various directives you want set. So this particular application wants the memory directive set to 16 megabytes. And so all of this kind of information. In addition, and this is going to be a little bit harder to see, I think, but there's a design view that allows you to specify parameters as well. So this is a design view of XML from inside Eclipse. And so I can specify that there's a parameter about DB type. I can even specify how it's supposed to be validated and what the valid values are. Now, how does that all come into play? Again, you come over here, and all I want to do is export this. So I say I'm going to export it as an archive file. I'm going to store it out there as test.zpk. The zpk extension is the extension we're looking for these packages, but it is just a zip file. I can say finish, and it's going to export that package. So within a few minutes of having an application that's running on my development desktop, now I have a package. So let's go over back over to Zend, and let's upload that package. So I pick the Drupal package. I tell it where I want this thing to be deployed, what URL. Eventually, you'll be able to specify things like if you want it vhost, different ports, other things like that. Let me zoom back out so I can get to my next button. So now what it has to do is upload this package and then read the information from the package about the various things that need to be displayed. The first thing it can display is a EULA. So if you're a commercial software vendor and you're writing a package and you want to deploy it on Zend server or through this deployment mechanism, you have access to display your EULA for customers before they get it. Then you can do next, and here we have a bunch of different parameters. So remember I said you can tell it which kind of database you want, so it's automatically building a UI to let the person configure the application at the point of deployment. So I need to fill in a few values here. And then let me zoom back out so I can actually see my buttons. So now what I'm going to do when I hit finish here is it's going to actually take this application and it's going to deploy it to 15 servers. So we've all done this in the past. You know how long that's going to take to deploy the application to 15 servers. Typically, you'd start SSH copying it over to the different servers. It would go through this process. It would basically have to update every single server. You'd do them in sequence or something. In this case, Zend Server is able to push this out of all the servers, stage it all, get it all in place, and then restart the PHP if necessary, and boom, within the amount of time I was explaining what was going on, it's actually deployed. And so if I click on it, what we're going to see now is we no longer get a 404 error. We get Arnold wondering what all of you people are going to do to California while you're here. And those of you that live here, you're probably already doing it to California. By the way, somebody suggested that perhaps the elephant was getting ready to commit suicide. I don't think so. He's just kind of enjoying the view, okay? But you never know. Now, what you see here is it came up on Web 01. Can you see this here in the top where it says it's on server Web 01? Again, I just wanted to show you that this is working so that it's coming up with through a load balancer to different servers. And as I cycle through, I get different kinds of information. Now, how was this all set up? So the way this was all set up was by using RightScale. So Andy talked about our partner RightScale. We can create deployment configurations with RightScale. We have some scripts that allow us to basically define the different servers. So like an application server, a Zend Server Cluster Manager, the database for Zend Server Cluster Manager, the various web servers. So you can see all of these different things. Let me zoom in a little bit here so you can actually see what I'm doing. You can see that RightScale is showing me what's going on these servers. They actually happen to be fairly heavily loaded at this point. And one of the things about RightScale, and how many people in here have actually ever seen RightScale or used it? Few. Okay, RightScale is a very comprehensive piece of software to allow you to create different configurations called deployments. You can set them up, say these are the servers that need to be running for a typical PHP application. So in this case, you need a database for your application. You need a Zend Server Cluster Manager. You need a bunch of Zend servers. And at the bottom here, we have something called a scaling array. And so basically what it's doing here is it's scaling up in this array and trying to decide whether we should add more servers to the system. So based on the definition in this array, we say we have between 0 and 10 servers. And, you know, we tell it what we want it to where we want to put the servers. We can even tell it how it's supposed to decide whether it scales up or down or not. In this particular case, it was defined as scaling up and down based on whether the number of Apache processes is fully utilized. So if we say each server can have up to, let's say, 150 Apache processes, when that server gets to its limit, then it starts to vote, in a sense, to grow the cluster. And the servers basically decide between themselves whether the load is consistent across the cluster and whether they want to vote for things to scale up and scale down. So what we can see here is we say, well, if 51% of the servers decide that we should scale up, then we'll scale up. If 51% decide we should scale down, we should scale down. And we're telling it how many we want to size up. And so you can see that all of the servers are voting that we should be growing. So these servers are saying, hey, we should be growing. Let's doing our thing. So now if we come over here and we look at how many instances are running, we can see that WriteScale has been watching the fact that this server was heavily loaded, and it's already added one new server to our cluster. Okay? And because the load hasn't gone down, it's starting to add a second server. So as the system gets heavily loaded, it can scale up servers. As the system gets lightly loaded, it can scale them back down. So if I go back to Zen Server Cluster Manager, and this is where you should all cross fingers for me because this is the part of the demo that always seems to be a little bit tricky. We can see that it's actually automatically scaled up one of the servers. And so if we go again back to WriteScale, we can actually go look at that server. We can actually go to that server itself on Amazon by going to its public DNS name, see that it's up. And if we put Drupal in at the end, you can see that it's actually automatically deployed the Drupal application to this server. So it's set the configuration, it's added that to the server, it's deployed the two applications. So we also have the WordPress application out here, assuming I can type. So you can see it's deployed those two applications. It will continue to do that as servers go up and down, and you can basically start to go look at various monitoring data. So in the monitoring data that we have out here, there's things going on in this system. We can go take a look at what's going on in the system at the events. And as I said, we can pick events that are happening a lot, like this curl function error. We can go look at it. We can see exactly which servers it happened on. So as I zoom in here, whoops, one too far. You can see that the new server is actually getting some errors, just like the old servers are. If I click on it, let me zoom out a little bit and scroll over. You can see what's going on with this error. We're getting a curl error. We can go look, see what the actual PHP error was. It couldn't connect to the host. So as a person diagnosing this, they say, well, wait a minute. Somewhere in my code, I'm calling something to connect to some host with curl. I'm not reaching it. There must be some configuration problem. I can start to diagnose that by actually showing the code tracing. Now, this I'm going to apologize for. I believe the font's going to be a little small. I don't think I can make it any bigger. But what you're seeing here is, in fact, all of the code flow for the program, where it spent its time. So here's where it's spending its time. Here's where the various information is. You can actually go through this information and see various pieces of data and drill down through and actually see where the code is going, what parameters are being passed to the code at various points. I'm actually going to switch over to another code trace that's a little bit easier to deal with as far as that is concerned. So let's go back to the events. Let's actually look at a slow query. Because if we're having slow queries, we know our application isn't going to run very fast. So here's an example of a slow query. Again, it's happening on a number of different servers. The queries are averaging, you know, more than a half a second. You can actually see the exact content of the query. So you can see exactly what was being passed to the query. You can actually see the information about what the request was, what the URL it was passed, any of the server data. You can actually see the backtrace in the code of exactly where this happened. And again, I picked the wrong one. Oops. So I can show the code trace again. And I apologize again for the font, but we'll do the best we can here. So we can increase it a little bit. What we've got here is a slow query. It actually had a PHP error, so the first thing we can do is go look at the PHP error because it might be related to the query, might not. We see that we're actually using, what this is telling me here is I'm using a deprecated method in my code, so I should probably fix that. My code's using old stuff that's no longer really officially supported. So that's the first thing. But that's not really helping us a whole lot. So we can actually go into code tracing, and we can actually have it sort by what's taking the most time. And we can see that the thing that's taking the most time that pops to the top here is the MySQL query. Well, I can see that. Some of you in the front row can see that. Guys in the back, sorry. Stop by the booth. We'll show you the same thing in the booth. And what we can see is that it's called 10 times. So if I click on it, it'll show me actually every single call that happens in here, how long they're taking. I can, again, sort these in both directions. I can see that this one query here is taking the most time. So if I look over, again, I've got the exact query that's going on. Or more importantly, I can go back to that call trace here and be right in the tree where the call trace happens. And I can basically see, hang on a second, do that one more time. I can basically see, let me see here, I can get my screen where I can actually see it. You can actually see where the call is, and you can basically walk yourself back up the tree and figure out, okay, that query is coming from this particular part of the code. That particular part of the code might be fetching the menus. Fetching the menus takes a really long time. Wait a minute, the menus, they don't really change while this application's running, so why don't I cache that data? And so you might be able to find diagnostically the kind of information that allows you to sort of see what's going on in your system, and this transparency happens automatically for you. So it's not like running something where you have to go run a profiling. This happens because of monitoring. So anytime monitoring detects anything that you define as significant, so in this case a slow query, a slow request, various information, it automatically captures this trace and will store it for you. So as a developer, you all have had these problems, maybe not, I don't know, I could be wrong. But people come to you and say, you know, the website was really slow yesterday. Great. Wonder what was going on when it was really slow. You don't know. No one knows, right? You try to reproduce it, you go to the website, super speedy right now, don't really know what's going on. We had a customer that had this exact problem where periodically his website would get really slow for like 2 minutes, and then it would speed back up. And he could never find the problem until he put code tracing in. What he found was that there was a certain search function in his code. And people could put really strange search queries into this code because he wasn't checking the input values properly, and it was making his database go into a coma for 2 minutes at a time. So what he found when he went into diagnose this problem was he found these queries that were taking 2.5 minutes. And he said, that might be a problem. And he went and looked at why, he traced back up through his code, he fixed it. So within about, I think, a half a day of him installing Zen Server and using code tracing, he found that. And that's going to come to you straight from the production systems, and you'll be able to look at that in Studio. You can actually import that into Studio, look at the code in Studio as well as in this code tracing. And again, so that's the kind of power that you have. Again, while we were away talking, we go back to cluster setup. We can see that we've added another server. It's probably on its way to adding a few more. And so that's sort of the gist of the demo that I wanted to get across, showing you the beginning of the deployment function, showing the beginning of scale up and scale down. Some of this stuff should be available before too awful long. Others will take a little bit longer before it finally ends up seeing, you know, in some future Zen Server version. But hopefully that gives you an idea of where we're headed and the kind of ideas that we're shooting for. Thanks, and I'll turn it back over to Andy.
I think a demo tells more than 1,000 words, and you saw this is a very cool stuff that we're doing. A lot of these things we've actually already done. So as I said, the work we've done in Zen Framework, Zen Server Cluster Manager, which helps you manage a cluster. But we're committed in the next few months to work very closely with the cloud management providers, cloud infrastructure providers, work on application deployment and the elasticity portion of this, and make sure that we really deliver a holistic Zen PHP cloud platform that works out of the box. As I said earlier, do it right for the masses, and I really wouldn't underestimate that. I think being able to do it right out of the box is something that most people have not been able to do, and we believe that we can help you do that.